2020 has not been the best one for us so far. The virus that shall not be named is mostly to do with that. And no, I'm not talking about J.K. Rowling when I'm saying that, even though she has been falling off of her broomstick with some Wingardium transphobia. But we'll just park her for this week because I'm not giving that any more time and attention than it deserves. But that coupled with the recent election events in Poland, I think it's safe to say that we are all potentially worried for our own safety, as well as for the safety and well-being of our global LGBTQ plus community. So I think that's where digital interfaces such as this one are so important, not only to connect with each other, who we already know many faces in our studio and Facebook audience, but also to meet some new faces and remind us all that even though it's a tough time, we're absolutely not alone. And as long as Cher doesn't announce retirement, we can still make it to 2021 with a smile on our faces, I'm sure. Even if other people don't always understand exactly where we're coming from, we will always be in vogue. And speaking of which, that brings us on to our first segment of the week. So if you'd like to pull up on your chair, grab a snack, we're going to dive into our critique of the week. Oh, I've left my background on there and you can't see me in all of my armchair glory. Right, let's just back that bus up. Right, there we go, that's better. Ah, see, look at me now, I've got the Paul O'Grady realness, that's what we're after. Right, so this week's critique of the week, got my big cup of tea there. We are going to be chatting about a slightly different alternative LGBT plus show, and it is called Dragula. Not Dracula with the fangs and the teeth, no, that one. Dragula with a G. Quite similar to other online, not online, well, it is online, it's not a streaming service, but similar to other reality competition shows related to drag, Dragula is slightly different in the sense that it focuses around the alternative, punky, grungy sort of style. So if you like a bit of horror and a wee bit of fake blood with your 301 eyelashes, then you should be listening up. So it's hosted by two drag hosts, they're actually a couple who work together, and their names are Drachmorda and Swanfula Boulay. Just sounds like an expensive appetizer, doesn't it? Like Tory macaroni or something. They created a competition club night in LA that they called Dragula. So it's kind of like an underground alternative style of drag pageant, where a lot of horror drag queens and alternative drag queens, punky drag queens would come together and compete one night to win money and to decide who was the best super monster of that night. So it started off, as I say, as just quite a small event, but then it slowly but surely grew into a larger pageant, grew into a big convention of pageants, and now it's on a streaming service on Amazon Prime. There's three seasons, so there's plenty to sink your wee vampire teeth into, but it's also really interesting because you can see the slightly lower budget has absolutely influenced the way that the show is produced. So there's some kind of B-movie horror skits at the very start of it. It's all very campy, it's very theatrical, but it's still got that tongue-in-cheek kind of humour to it. It doesn't take itself seriously, which clearly I'm a fan of. So it started out, series one was open to just local queens in LA, because that's where the original Dragula pageants and Dragula competition nights were. People could move to LA and compete if they wanted to, but because there was really not a lot of budget for the performers, they worked off of just tips and donations made from the audience. So they did have a cash prize, but it was all just put together from fans, and it was really the super monsters of drag who were interested in just getting together, throwing some big blood and stuff, giving people a bit of a spook, a bit of a scare, but also showcasing their raw talents and also showing there's much more to horror drag than just dripping fake blood all over the place, which I think some people think that that's all it takes. those who are familiar with drag will know that there's many different styles of drag, and it's not always the rhinestones and kind of looking and trying to look female. Sometimes it is, but for these drag queens, they tend to focus more on the monstrous side of drag. So they wear things like kind of fangs, they've got humongous great big wigs, wearing things like barbed wire, armour plated dresses, it's all that kind of stuff. So there is sometimes a feminine aspect to it, but more often than not, it's just an art form on stage, which I also think is quite interesting to get that out into the mainstream, particularly with some comments that were made around other kind of mainstream drag being focusing on that kind of looking like a female. So it's interesting to see another mainstream drag show really try and bring different elements to the forefront and show people that there's more to drag, and also anyone can do drag. The four pillars that they look at are of course drag, but they also focus on horror, filth and glamour, which is very interesting because we quite often see this glamorous side of drag, the big heels, the big hair, big eyelashes, gorgeous makeup, but we don't always see the horror and the filth, and if we do, it's quite often in a smaller aspect, it's kind of secondary. Whereas a lot of these queens, they focus on filth. So for example, one of the challenges was to create your own performance art based around these different pillars. So there was one based on horror, create your own horror character. One was based on glamour, shows your most glamorous look. And the other one was based on filth. And that one was jaw-droppingly shocking. I mean, honestly, my grandmother would be turning in her freshly made bed if she'd seen that one. It was really quite shocking. People making themselves vomit. People getting a fake toilet and like pretending to eat out of the toilet and all this kind of stuff. It's definitely not for those with a weak stomach. But if you're into that kind of shocking performance art, it is definitely worth a watch. It's fantastic. As I'd said, it's on a slightly lower budget. It's not spending thousands upon thousands of pounds, but that's where the charm is for me. That's where I think you really see the raw talent of people come through, because it's not being covered in lots of money being thrown at something. Sometimes easier to make something look really good if you're spending £1,000 per episode, but if you're really not getting that sort of revenue, and you need to be a little bit more clever. Even now, on its third series, the Bully Brothers themselves, even though they're the hosts, they quite often make a lot of the props and a lot of the set for the show, which I think, as artists watching, that's something that's quite interesting as well. They're not relying on these expensive set designers. They are not afraid to get their hands dirty and get in a bit of the paper mache themselves. So I raise my tea to that one. Mm-hmm. Now, every season, you do see the slightly bigger budget being given, which is great, but it's not losing that real underground kind of drag element. That is what drag is supposed to be in the first place, isn't it? It's supposed to be something that's a little bit provocative, it kind of ruffles feathers, so it's nice to see a show that really amplifies that. The whole point of every challenge is to try and make waves, really try and push buttons. And of course, being the youngest in my family, I love pushing buttons and I love folk that can do it well. I think one of the most interesting aspects of it is, in order to get kicked out of the competition, the bottom queens engage in extermination challenges. So again, keeping in with this 80s B-movie sort of horror style, instead of just leaving the competition, they actually kill off each queen every week, which is very theatrical, and I love a bit of that. They get to make up their own death scene and enact that. So there's people that, you know, get in kind of like the sort of axe murderer sort of scene that we've seen, the psycho, like in the shower. And anyone who's really interested in horror films and those classic kind of horror films, but also the ones that are so cheesy and really quite badly made almost, this is the one to watch. It's so funny and it's just got that real element of humour behind it always, which again is something that I think drag is intended for. It's intended to entertain as well as intended to showcase the art that is required to put in. Such extermination challenges include putting people into coffins full of bugs and just seeing who can last the longest, making them take baths full of ice water for over 30 minutes, so like standing in the ice water and how little do you scream or kind of make a fuss, that's who they determine stays. And probably one of the most off-putting ones for me, being a vegan, is when they have to eat the pig brains out in a scorching desert. Now don't worry, the pig brains are ethically sourced, so we can rest easy about that. But it definitely shows the amount of hard work and the amount of dedication that that everyone is putting in order to take part in this competition. There's only been one person who's ever walked off and refused to do an extermination challenge, but it wasn't even for those ones, it was a different one. So again, it just shows how serious these people are about their craft, about their art form, and it's good drama, so it's good telly. Now, the idea about the extermination challenges, it has a lot of people divided. It's very controversial because a lot of folk are saying that it's a drag competition. You're there to showcase your drag. You're there to showcase your art. Why should you have to be plunged into ice water? Why should you need to jump out of a plane? Why should you have to go and, you know, shoot each other with paintball guns without any armour plate? That's ridiculous. That's not part of drag. I understand that point of view. However, again, looking at it from an artistic point of view, the main point that the Boulay brothers, the hosts, make is that when you do these kind of extermination challenges, it's never something that's going to seriously harm or put the contestants in any real danger. It's looking to try and draw out that primal part of people in order to make them try and survive. Now, that also couples with how they're trying to survive in the competition. They're specifically trying to say, look how strong you are. So don't worry if you can't make a dress. The dress won't hem. Your sewing machine's broken. Your makeup's not going right. Sometimes artists, you can see a lot of them getting really frustrated in the show. But I think to me, the point of the extermination challenge is to go, look what you can overcome. That's the point. And I think that's really interesting. As well as that, the main reason that I love Dragula so much is because it looks at all aspects of drag. So even though they're looking at filth, horror and glamour as their three pillars, the styles of drag are all completely different. There's queens in there that have been like video game kind of characters, so it's all quite kind of pixelated makeup and they're kind of like weird sort of cartoon characters. Then there's also pageant queens that have got glorious makeup and stones and, you know, really expensive looking costumes, and they're really polished and particular about how they do things. They have queens on there dressed as monsters with, you know, the fangs and the lizards, kind of split tongues. They have queens on there that really focus on filth and using real props like real bugs and, you know, using real blood and piercing themselves and stapling themselves. It looks at such a vast area of drag, and you look at it and you think, I really didn't care who's going to win. This could be anyone's game because everyone's so different. And I think that makes it more interesting because you're not looking at a cookie cutter of three or four different queens that look the same. And another reason that Dragula is my personal favourite go-to drag show. Having said that, I love all shows that exhibit drag because it is something that has been underground and not a lot of people are interested in it. I loved drag from such a young age. I loved the Lily Savage. I loved Eddie Izzard. My mum and dad used to watch the Vine films. Like, I've always loved it. It was never something that anyone else really got a chance in my friend group to be aware of. And now that it's a bit more mainstream, it's great that more people are exposed to it. But why I tend to gravitate towards Dragula specifically is they really try to showcase not only all styles of drag, but all types of people. So you have people that have got various genders on there. They've had cis men, cis women. They've had trans men and trans women. They've had non-binary people. They've had people that identify as gender fluid but leaning towards one gender and vice versa. They also showcase many different races, different religions. They have different sizes of bodies as well, and not just kind of one or two, but actually the entire cast is completely different. Also, listen to one of their most recent podcasts because I was doing my research. Thank you very much, Out Crowd. They were saying that even though they're looking to be more inclusive, they don't want to go, okay, well, that's enough inclusivity, we can just keep going. They were even saying they're trying to bring inclusivity more into their production team. They'd looked at the production team from series one and said that there was a lot of white cisgender men that were working there. So they tried to advertise in different places so they could try and appeal to more people and a more varied sense of people, which is also really admirable. That's for the cast as well as for production crew, because a lot of people just want anyone to come on and work for cameras and do what they need to do. But they're really trying to make a difference behind the camera as well as in front of the camera, which I very much appreciate. Is there any questions from the studio audience about Dragula, perhaps an episode, or perhaps any themes, or perhaps where it can be found? And if you don't, it's all right as well.
Where can you find Dragula?
I didn't actually say that, did I? That's dreadful. So you can find it on Amazon Prime. Now, I hope nobody from Amazon's watching this, but I use my mum's account. She doesn't watch it, so I'm allowed to just go on. She doesn't actually use it. So it is on Amazon Prime. However, you can also go onto YouTube and type in, like, Dragula Season 1, Episode 1, and there is some full episodes on there as well. They've got the adverts in between, but no different to what you get on ITV. So you can find it on Amazon or YouTube, just whatever. And I'm sure that it's supposed to be coming to Netflix in the UK. It's in Netflix in the US just now, but I think they've got a slightly different kind of platform. How they work it depends on the country. So we should be getting it at the end of this year. So keep your eyes peeled for it. Fabulous. Well, from there then, I think that my roundup for Dragula is essentially it's worth a watch if you're really not into horror, you don't like all that, you just want to, you know, just watch a wee cartoon or something in the evening. It's maybe not for those with a weak stomach, anyone who's got any particular fears of like spiders, snakes, bugs, heights, and watching something like that might be a little bit concerning for you, might put you on edge. I wouldn't advise watching it because they definitely don't filter anything out. It's carefully edited, but they definitely show you absolutely everything. So be a mindful, maybe read the blurb of things before it comes out, just to make sure like that you're not going to pass out in the middle of the living room. But if you want to give it a wee watch, as I said, it's on Amazon Prime at the moment or YouTube, coming up to Netflix, and it's absolutely worth a watch to show the inclusivity of drag, how many different genders can do drag, and all of the different styles of drags that we can have to offer. And it's also a reminder that you can follow all of the queens on their social medias. They've all got their Twitter and their Facebook. And I'd also encourage to have a wee look on Instagram hashtags and see what other styles of drag you can find. Quite a lot of people follow drag queens and makeup artists. Maybe have a wee look and see if you do follow any horror-based queens or any filth-based queens. And if not, maybe have a wee look on the internet first, see how you like it, and then you can decide from there if you think it's a good idea to move forward. Now, moving on from that, I think that it's safe to say that we can try our next segment, and it's time for the weather, girl. It's raining men. Hallelujah, it's raining men. Amen. Them. Hello there, and it's time for our weather segment. Raining them. First of all, it's said that a giant rainbow is set to appear over Scotland schools for the foreseeable future. Experts say that this is due to LGBTQ plus issues being added to the school curriculum. Is the reason why. Now, we're hoping that there's no nasty blue rain clouds to come in and spoil this magnificent change. So it's safe to say that any allies or members of the LGBTQ plus community, keep your brawlies on hand and just reflect those haters' raindrops as and when you need to. Next up, it's been exceptionally cloudy this month with Lady Gaga fans spotted on top of the ninth cloud inn. Not only has Mother Monster herself announced rescheduled tour dates for 2021, but also she has been named as the number one pop star in the world right now after her release of her new album Chromatica. Madonna fans are yet to comment. And finally, in more serious news, there has been dark storm clouds circling over Europe, specifically over Poland, after events surrounding their elections have turned sour for the LGBTQ plus communities. More will be revealed over on our next segment, which is all about current affairs, or as we like to call them, our raisin liaisons. Right. So, on our Raisin Liaisons this week, we're going to be taking a deep dive into politics. Now, it's never something that we like to discuss willy-nilly. It's always something that's going to be there. It's always going to be people that are going to have opposing views against the LGBTQ plus community. So I think it's important that we do take a few moments just to touch on that and just raise awareness for the issues that are happening around Poland, specifically the last couple of weeks. So the recent elections have stirred concern, worry, and potentially even fear for the LGBTQ plus community. Andrzej Duda is gaining massive support for anti-LGBTQ plus politics. He's branded our community as more destructive than communism. One third of Poland, or the equivalent of one third of Poland, has declared itself an LGBT-free zone. This is a move that's been condemned recently by the EU Commission as a breach of fundamental human rights. Now, images have been shared across news outlets as well as online of rainbow flags being burned, stones being hurled at LGBTQ plus protesters and people just walking down the street. But also, it's not surprising that many people have made the decision to leave Poland as a country, not just a hometown, and it's doubtful if they'll ever come back or not. That was on interviews that were shown by BBC's coverage of the Polish elections. On that same BBC news report, one protester's advice to young people in Poland was to, quote, leave as it's not going to get better. So that just shows you the severity of the situation that's going on there at the moment. Having said that, many people have chosen to remain in Poland and protest and fight for their right to live openly and live freely, and they want to maintain that exposure of this is who we are, and you can't just get rid of people and brand them as all being part of something that you disagree with simply because you disagree with them. Now, it's no secret, I'm in a flat in Fife. I'm not in Poland at the moment and I haven't been there, so it's difficult for me to say exactly what it's like over in Poland just now or how it has been there growing up in the recent years. So I'd like to pass over to two of our special guests who are in our Zoom studio audience today. Thank you so much again for both of you joining us. I'm just going to come a wee bit closer so I can actually see you there. So we're going to go on to our first special guest, Remy. Hello, Remy. If you'd like to introduce yourself.
Hello, everyone. My name is Remy. I moved to Edinburgh 4 years ago to join my gorgeous boyfriend. And basically since then, it feels like a new chapter, the new quality of life, understandment, acceptance. And I cannot believe that I can proudly say that Scotland is my new home. I recently organized the protest outside the Polish consulate Edinburgh in support for Polish LGBTQ plus communities. And the outcome of this protest is overwhelming for me. There is so many people asking for help. And I believe that we can apply changes in Poland because, yeah, we need to apply changes in Poland. We need to act right now. My experience of teenagehood in Poland wasn't the happiest, I'd say, because in Poland, homophobia is socially accepted and you can always hear the weird constructs. Yeah, just everything. People will just throw it on you, which is sad in a way because Polish constitutions say about equality and protect the equality. However, in my opinion, if you're different in Poland, you're just gonna hear weird things about you. That's the thing.
And is that something that you found to be quite common for other LGBT plus people in Poland?
To be honest, I feel that Poland, when I left, has changed drastically over the last 4 years, and it's not the country that I remember being the same anymore, in my opinion, because the Law and Justice Party basically took over the whole country and they're using the worst manipulative and communistic methods to basically brainwash people's minds and to actually make them think that these people are pedophiles, these people are ideology, these are not humans. And I've been quiet basically all my life, I never been confident enough to speak up and share my story. And when the presidential election campaign came out, and when I heard the president comparing us to an ideology, to even worse than communism, something just broke in me, because basically it reminded me all of those terrific and traumatic memories from my teenagehood. And yeah, I become an LGBTQ plus activist over last month. And we will change it for sure, especially with Scottish support, European support, everyone's support.
Absolutely. Kaz, we've got another guest, sorry. Kasia, would you like to introduce yourself as well?
Hi, I'm Kasia, and I'm also from Poland, and I'm actually based here now. So I'm experiencing all of this bad situation here on my own skin. And like Remy said a lot, but I agree that the situation changed a lot during the recent events, especially during the campaign, like the anti-LGBTQ plus campaign run by our current president, because he unfortunately won the election. And I remember like the times when me and my friends were like making jokes about each other's, like, don't be so gay because you will get beaten up or something. And it was terrifying, but it wasn't so real. And now, after all of this, like, words that we heard, it's actually super real. Like, I'm actually scared, I'm actually afraid that one day it will happen, that I will get beaten up because I'm gay, because I have a different orientation. And that's really terrifying. And, you know, it's also my perspective, and I'm already out. I'm not ashamed of who I am, but we have a lot of people in Poland that are still afraid of coming out, that are still fighting with this. And, like, I just can't imagine what they feel after like hearing this kind of words, that they are not meant, they are an ideology, a rainbow flag, and that they are worse than Bolshevism and Nazism. And how should they feel? How should they react when they are so afraid? Because this country now, like, Poland never been tolerant, in my opinion, in any way. But now it's actually super bad, and I don't know how they feel, because I don't know what would I do if I wouldn't be like out and, you know, confident, because I think I am, but it's going in a really, really bad direction in here.
Mm-hmm. You'd mentioned before we'd started the show about your current location in Poland, and it's kind of like a safer area in Poland. Do you want to just kind of tell the rest of the folks watching about where you are just now, if comfortable?
I'm actually based in Poznan, and I think we can call Poznan like one of the most tolerant cities in Poland. When like the government been making this, all of these LGBT free zones, Poznan been fighting with this. Like, the mayor of Poznan was like opposite, so they've been fighting with this. They were like super supportive, and here in Poznan we have a lot of like LGBT friendly places and like clubs, so I think we can feel secure. But it's not like super common in Poland. Like, I come from like a really small city, and I don't have to say that I'm gay. I just look like maybe a bit, let's say, different, more like colorful or something, and people are looking in like a not kind way. So feel it in the air, like, yeah.
Totally. I think we all, even though we're not in Poland with you, I think definitely everyone in the community knows what that's like, just to feel like you're getting kind of looks, you know, whether it's always kind of like you're trying to sort of add up how you're coming across. What would you kind of say is things that maybe Scottish people could, or people in the UK and Scotland, the rest of Europe, what would you say is things that we can do to really help people, not only Polish people who have left Poland, but particularly those like yourself that are still there? Is there anything we could do to really kind of help raise awareness, help people understand exactly what's happening?
I think it's all about awareness and like letting people know that they are not alone. They have somebody that supports them, because like I said before, like there is no equality and compassion from the government that should like protect everybody. So I think like the most important thing that like the other countries can do, it's just letting all of those people, like the community, LGBTQ plus community in Poland, know that they are supported, they are like worth fighting for. I think it's, for now it's this, because what else can you do when the government is just doing what they want? And so
yeah. Absolutely. I'd like to also pass over to Remy as well. Remy, same, just to say, kind of same thing. Is there anything you can kind of think that Scottish people, UK-based people, other European countries can do to help raise awareness and just make sure that this doesn't get forgotten about in a week or two?
Yes, well, like Afka has said, just I feel like awareness and education, it's something that is happening in Europe right now, is probably one of the most important things. But also maybe searching Polish LGBTQ charities and organizations and maybe donating smaller sums to them, because I believe that they're under the threat right now of the government for the moment. So I feel like these small communities that are actually working in Poland for the moment to apply the change or maybe organize a parade, I feel like they would benefit from that. But the awareness and education, just talking about the issue, I feel like this can make a huge impact. And maybe protesting outside the Polish consulates around Europe, just showing that there is no acceptance for such a hate speech and dehumanizing language methods that are used against our community in Poland. Yeah, I'm actually thinking about maybe doing another protest or event in Edinburgh with another support, because we can't stop. There is another couple of years with the Law and Justice government ahead, and I don't even want to think what those 3 or 5 years might brought for the community. And it already did so much harm, and it just worries me that then Polish society will completely turn back on people. Mm-hmm. We have to remember that it's horrific for me that it's territory where like Nazi used to kill homosexuals, gays, lesbians, and Auschwitz, and yet 80 or 90 years later, the leaders, the Catholic leaders, the national leaders are basically using similar methods against the same community yet again. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, we just have to show that there's no acceptance for that.
100%. Well, if and when you get the chance to organise that protest, do let us know and we can share it out on Ever and Out Crowd sessions. I think that would be, it'd be really great to help spread awareness for that. I'd just like to pass on to the Zoom studio audience. Does anyone get any questions or any observations that they'd like to chat with Kasia and Remy about?
Honestly, just hearing that, you know, you guys have had to like go through so much, like if people said like something to me, I'm like, oh, like someone said something, like just ignore it, brush it off. Like you don't actually realise that, like, even though like here we're still a minority and like we can be discriminated against, a lot of people are still going through like the things that like people in our country could have went through like those like 80 or 90 years ago. Like you don't really think about the fact that that's still actually actively happening. Like you hear about it, but you don't realize like how much, like how many people that's actually affected and how relevant that is to your life and what you could do to change that. So it's really good to hear that like I could actually actively help that instead of just being like, that's bad, but actually, you know, I could step up and be like, no, that's wrong and you need to change that. It's just really inspirational, yeah.
Yeah, I totally agree. It's really inspirational. I think it's very easy sometimes to forget that these things don't happen. It's hard to think that they happen anywhere. It's very difficult to think about it happening somewhere in Poland that's just, you know, so close to the UK, so close to Scotland. Lots of people, even in this Zoom audience just now, have been to Poland. And, you know, me and Tommy were even just chatting, saying, like, oh, you know, like I was going to go on holiday to Poland and now I actually have to double check that and think actually is it safe for members of our community to go to places. So it's even more horrible to know that there is members of our community that are going through that just now. So with that, we are kind of I do want to just quickly ask Remy and Kasia, have you got any just final kind of words that you'd like to share with us just now?
Can I come in and ask Remy about the news you told us at the beginning when we were backstage? Because I think
Yeah.
it's a really positive action. Thank you.
So basically, right now, throughout the Europe, the twin regions and partnership with Polish LGBTQ free zones are being recently broken. It seems like Europe is taking action with that. And yeah, and I found out that Krakow is in partnership with Edinburgh, and Krakow is the capital of the Lesser Poland region, which has been declared as the LGBTQ plus free zone. And hopefully, maybe there will be a sign from Edinburgh or like a small impulse. There is no acceptance for these kind of speech actions towards our community. And yeah, and we'll see what's going to happen with this. Although I believe that with breaking, we need to unite as well, because I feel that the cultural difference that is in Scotland would be very valid and relevant for our Polish communities. So it's a very, very tough one.
Definitely. Oh, go for it, whoever that was, sorry.
Yeah, I was just wondering, Remy, what your experience like as an LGBT person so far has been like in Scotland coming here, and if you feel like you are supported enough by the kind of infrastructures in place here.
Oh yeah, definitely. I work as a support practitioner, and I had to like learn all of the acts, protocols, and the supports here, even given by the law. It's honestly overwhelming for me, and obviously in a good way, because it seems to me like every single human is being protected for the moment. Maybe not everyone, but majority. Of course, it's still difficult to apply the current law for everybody, but like, as I said before, Scotland, it's like a paradise for me. Just to be here in the dreamy and lovely Edinburgh. And yeah, I never witnessed so much compassion for other. I never witnessed so much love and understanding towards equality and basic human rights. And honestly, I'm just so proud that I got the opportunity to live here and be the part of this community and to create and make some impact in the world and in the Europe.
We're so happy to have you here,
Thank
Remy. Honestly, so
you
happy.
so much
And
for having me.
yeah, and same as well, Kaja, so thankful that you were able to join us from Poland as well. Of course, as we'd mentioned, any information you have about protests, about things, petitions, that's all things that we can do. We don't have to physically be in Poland in order to help raise awareness and help the cause and just really stand up and show up for our European brothers, sisters and siblings. That's what our community is about. And particularly at this moment in time, we can definitely do what we need to do from Scotland, because I'm sure if it was the shoe was on the other foot and we were needing that help, it would be people like yourselves that would be stepping up and helping us. So anytime there's any of that information, we'll definitely keep in contact with both of you. And just thank you so much again for joining us this evening and taking time out of your evening to chat to us. So thank you.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you.
Thank you. So with that being said, I think it's time that we have a wee look at how proud we are to be LGBT plus and do a little quiz based on some of the things that we are proud to call part of our community. It's time to get quizzical.
Let's get quizzical.
Hello, so we're back. We're going to be getting quizzical. So it's just a super quick, super fun wee quiz, and it's all going to be based on things that are related to the LGBT plus community and related to Pride. What we've done is we've zoomed right in on different pictures, different pictures that represent things in our community, and I'd like you to try and guess what they are. And the winner wins a sense of pride. There we go. So first up, we have number one. You will get 20 seconds to guess what this is. 20 seconds. Have a wee look. See what you see. Have a wee think. I've said 20 seconds. I might give you less time. It depends how mean I'm feeling. So it's different colours. Very sparkly. And I'll give you 5, 4, 3, 2. The answer is a pot of glitter. Biodegradable, of course. We're saving the penguins. It's a pot of glitter that we would have been popping on our faces walking down Pride. So, next time, that's just a wee warm up. Let's see if yous can figure out the answer. So, this is the next one. Two of these colours together. Where have we seen them together before? Have a wee think. Now, this time, I'm going to throw it open to the floor. Does anyone think they know the answer? Just unmute yourself and buzz in.
Is that the new Pride flag?
Let's have a wee look and see if you're right there. Is it the new Pride flag? It is the new Pride flag. Well done there, Emmeline Hadley. And well done anyone else who got the first one as well.
I apologise.
The next one is this. Zoom right in. What do we think? Any ideas? I think he's a clue and all if you need it. See what you see. See what you see. Any Mr. Chips to help you? Any ideas? Like, yeah, a clue. It is often worn by a specific drag queen. Very famous drag queen.
RuPaul.
Let's see if you're right there, Remy. It is RuPaul. It's the RuPaul wig specifically is what we zoomed in on there. But it was RuPaul as a whole. Well done, well done. All right, last one. Here we go. What could that possibly be? Another great queen. It's associated with Snow RuPaul. Different one.
Is it Madonna's mouth?
Very close. Madonna's mouth on something. That sounds wrong. But face on a thing. And recently. Things that she sells. Sometimes online, you might go and wait in line at HMV and buy it. Maybe no, that's a bit 2012.
A record or a CD?
I'll give it to you both. It is Madonna's most recent album. Zoomed in the wee corner of your mouth there. Thankfully, should
that Madonna did not endorse us using this image the same. But well done, everyone. That was Let's Get Quizzical. Give yourselves a round of applause. Fabulous. Ha-ha. All right. Oh, I need to take that off. Oh, I'm so sorry. Oh, I'm no good at all this. There we go. Right, back in the studio now. So to finish off with then, we have also got a wee culture segment. Yes, don't you wish your culture was inclusive like this? So to look at our culture, we are going to be having a wee look at some of Shaper Caper's work. So we're going to be having a wee look at a dance film called Them, which is myself as the dance artist, but Thomas Small, our artistic director, was the brains behind the operation. He chose music, choreography, did all the filming and all the editing as well. So it's not really a joint project. It's definitely his. Just my face that's on it. It was part of our LGBT or other LGBT project called Hear Me Out. And it was created during a week of research and development for our touring production, our new touring production called No Offence. No Offence will be looking specifically at LGBT plus issues and also bullying that's aimed more for young people. So we are in the process of working that out. We've been working on that for a little while. And this particular film, over the course of the week, we were looking at different things to do with trans identities and non-binary identities. So over that week, we were looking at complications around toilet spaces and how there's a lack of inclusivity there, how they are quite difficult for people that don't identify as cis male or cis female, and how that felt, what that was like. We looked at stories that we knew of people personally and also stories like blogs and articles online. We looked at, as I said, non-binary folks, and specifically around also menstruating, the difficulties that non-binary and trans people have around either having a period or not having a period. This film raises issues to do with the non-binary experience because it's myself that's dancing in it, and it mainly looks at the difficulties around being in toilets that don't necessarily have how you identify above the door. So I'm just going to play that film for you just now, and then we'll have a wee conversation about it and see if there's any questions. So I'll let Tommy take it away.
I can tell you, it's not that I'm in denial about what's going on inside my body.
Inside my body.
I can also tell you, I don't really mind having ovaries or a womb. It's these things in front of my chest. The presence of these things in the past has caused me constant distress, caused me feelings of depression and an overwhelming, overbearing feeling of not quite belonging. So when I ask to be referred to as they, it's only to fool my unconscious mind and kind of distract me from what's going on in front of my body and sort of shield you from what's happening behind closed doors. It's like I'm a hard drive plugged into an incompatible computer. I can't reboot the software. Switching out the hardware is more than the option. If I could reprogram myself to be content with what was going on in front of here, I would. I can't reboot the software because I don't want to take pills. I don't want expensive surgeries. Pills. Expensive surgeries.
I just want to reboot my hard drive.
Reboot the hard drive.
Surgeries.
I I don't want to take pills. I don't want expensive surgeries.
I just want to reboot the hard drive. I don't want to take pills. I just want to reboot the hard drive.
Called Them. I don't know about anybody else, but now that was shot in February and it gives me fear to watch that now with all of the everything that's happened since. Like, I would never shoot in a toilet ever again. That is like, I'm looking at it when I'm touching the urinals going, oh, you should have got some anti-bac or just doused your hands in bleach or something, I don't know. So yeah, I would like to then sort of pass over to Tommy. Tommy, how did you find creating that kind of film? Is that something that you'd really done before as Shaper Keeper?
I thought, I know it's so weird you should say that. I was just watching it as well thinking, OMG, it's really, really weird kind of watching it now. But yeah, I think we wanted to, when we started making that piece, No Offence, we started making it probably about 2 years ago. And well, actually, that's a lie. In fact, we've been trying to make this show, No Offence, since actually about 2012. And for whatever reason, we just never quite managed to get the kind of support or opportunity to kind of develop it and take it further. There's always kind of some kind of hurdle to kind of get over. And it's kind of, it's been hard to get support for it, which is really interesting when you think about, you know, different equalities. And in some ways you might think that, you know, it might be in some way easier because it's about dealing with a protected characteristic, it's about dealing with equalities, but actually it's not. It's been a real struggle. I'm sure our producer Yolanda can tell you that it's been a real struggle to try and actually galvanise the support. For whatever reason that is, we don't know, but it has been really difficult to make art about that subject matter. So we've bought, fortunately, I think about 2 years ago, we got some funding from Creative Scotland to start developing the idea. And we started, first of all, we were kind of literally going through like the kind of LGBTQ plus kind of, you know, representations of kind of genders and sexualities, and trying to make sure that actually we're trying to make sure everyone is kind of recognized within the world that we're creating, and make sure that there's a role model, there's someone in there, that there's someone that you recognize as a young person. Because I should have said the show is for young people. Yes, forgot to say that, sorry. For teenagers. And it was about, for me, I don't know how you all feel, but for me, kind of growing up in the 80s, as if I just revealed that online about the age. but you know, growing up in the 80s, then, you know, I grew up during the AIDS crisis, and grew up where actually it was, you know, it was kind of landmark TV. If there was a gay kiss, or, you know, whether that was men or women, it was a huge, huge moment on TV. And I think when you know, I was growing up, I had Madonna, and you know, slagging off Madonna earlier there, Alex, but I didn't know it, thank you. But you know, Madonna was kind of like the one who was kind of on TV kind of as saying, you know, actually it's okay to be who you are, it's okay to express yourself. I'm gonna be able to go down a pure karaoke thing song now. But you know, for me that was like really important to kind of see role models there that actually go, you know what, the kind of thing you see on a normal basis where actually you don't feel like you fit into that kind of heteronormative kind of point of view, actually it's okay to be different. So I think for me that was a real eye-opener, and I've kind of thought that, you know, we do lots of work in schools with Shape a Caper, and we quite often find those kids like me, like us, in schools who maybe aren't quite at that point where they can feel like they can identify that they've met other people in their lives who are like them, and that they have a tribe, they have a community, they have a sense of belonging to other people. And for, you know, for me, when I found that, and I'm sure that kind of resonates around the room tonight, when I found that, I suddenly felt like, wow, now I can start to understand who I am, and now I can kind of shape kind of what my views on the world, and have that feeling of having the right to you know, to express my opinions. And I think that's what I'm really taken about tonight by Kasia and Remy, with your stories about, you know, everything you're saying just makes me feel like, wow, you know, it's so difficult to even contemplate what that must be feel like, you know. And I feel really, yeah, you know, really encouraged by you kind of having the kind of bravery to come on as well and actually talk about that so openly about your own personal experience. It's, you know, it's hard to talk about your personal experience in any situation, never mind, you know, a hugely turbulent political situation in your home country. So what we kind of wanted to do with this piece of work was, we then came to the realization that what we kind of looked through was, I looked at it through a cis gay male point of view, and we also looked at it from a kind of point of view of if someone was bi or if someone was a lesbian, and we kind of realized that actually kind of the trans voice and kind of non-binary experience weren't actually represented in the show. So we then worked with Alex on making this this piece of work. So Alex, I wonder, when you watch that, I've got a question for you now, if that's okay. I wonder, when you watch that, how do you feel about that when you watch that? I mean, apart from the toilets, with the old corona.
If you want to run like this and like steep my hands in Dettol, I find it just watching any other video of me dancing. I don't really get, other than that my hair was banging, like I loved my hair at that point. Now I look like a Skittle mixed with a beetle or something. It's like they need cut for real. But no, like I just see it as like any other film, any other, yeah, just whatever. Don't really, doesn't stun me in any way until I start kind of sinking down, like in between the toilet and the wall. And when it's kind of like the hand over the face and sort of pulling it away, that is something that I don't watch that part. I think I've watched it once because it's just a bit too real. It's a bit too raw to really watch it in full and sort of separate myself from it being work and it being a dance piece and just being choreography that you've asked me to do. And actually a very real visual representation of how it does feel to be in, to almost have something as ridiculous as a toilet space make you feel so small. And I think that's something that is not just specific to trans and non-binary people. I've heard many, not any personal friends, but I've heard many people that I follow on Instagram, things like that, people who are gay women, that have said that they've had that kind of experience in a female toilet, gay men that have had that experience in a male toilet. Like, it's so, I know it's not just specific to trans and non-binary people. I think it is something that across our community, toilets are a very touchy subject, and it's just still really difficult to think of that because you're like, I just want to go for a pee. That's all. that's all we need. That's all we want. So, and the kind of covering of the mouth and then the kind of over track of people laughing is something that is beautiful to watch as a spectator, but as not only the dancer in it, but as someone who it's about, it's really quite raw still to watch. Yeah, it's quite difficult.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting as well, kind of thinking about that people are so hung up on toilets that it really makes you kind of wonder, like, what's people's problem? Why are you so concerned with people going to the toilet? What is this weird perversion with that point of view about, you know, who's using what toilet? And I think, you know, the whole thing, not to get into a whole kind of J.K. Rowling thing right now, because we've got that for a subject matter for another week. But, you know, it's really interesting kind of, you know, hearing J.K. Rowling kind of try and justify her kind of reasoning, yeah, when actually she's been told over and over and over again about people who are actually concerned, how they feel, and actually how language is important, and about her choice of, and as an author knows that language is important, her whole business is about language, and yet she still chooses to use that as a vehicle for her to peddle her, you know, her point of view, and actually not be willing to back down and go, ooh, I might have got this wrong. So I think for me, it felt like quite timely to have that mm-hmm. conversation a few months ago. And unfortunately, we're still in that space, and it's not moved on. I think, you know, there's a whole other thing as well about the fact that she chose to bring that whole kind of her whole essay to the world at the point in the middle of Black Lives Matters as well, also just makes you kind of wonder her kind of justification and her reasoning about why she thought all of that was appropriate in any way, never mind, you know, in the middle of, first of all, a pandemic, and second of all, you know, Black Lives Matters. So I think there's still a huge amount of work to be done. I think art is really important in these spaces, and it allows people to express themselves, it allows people to question what's going on in the world, and to look at it through a filter of someone else, and to hold up a mirror to society and kind of reflect back what we're kind of seeing. And I hope that in some way that piece of work, that film, I think does stand alone in its own right, but it will be part of a bigger narrative. It's also part of, we were funded by the National Lottery Heritage Fund on a project that we mentioned, you might have seen pop up at the end of the film, called Hear Me Out, where we're looking to get LGBTQ+ voices and recorded as part of an oral history archive that just documents the importance of people in the LGBTQ world and make sure that actually they are represented. So we're working with our History Scotland and to make sure that actually we are allowing LGBTQ+ voices to be heard and to be archived for history forevermore, to once and for all go, we are important, our voices count. And yeah, now stepping off my soapbox.
No, you're completely right, Tommy, and I think that that's also so valid with everything that we've kind of talked about tonight, with what's happening in Poland and other countries, with the comments that people like J.K. Rowling are making, all of these different things that seem to collect all together, and it makes it sometimes, I think most people that I've spoke to personally in the LGBTQ+ community since the pandemic hit has had at least one moment of I can't go on, this is just too much, you know, whether it's in a place at home that you don't feel supported, whether it's been cut off from friends and your kind of chosen family. I think most people have had that experience since this all happened in March or end February, whenever it was, that it's been really difficult to move on. Art has been the thing that has been really helping push people forward, and I think that's what makes sessions like this one so important. And I just want to thank again to Claire Leslie, Emma Andromeda, and Eleanor for joining us tonight. Thank you, Eleanor, as well, for your help in curating the project and kind of getting out there. And of course, a massive, massive thank you to Kaja and to Remy, because it's much easier to sit and just Google things and go, oh, that's awful, but to hear it coming from you and really telling us your own personal story, as well as giving us a better insight into what's happening, is incredibly brave of yous and incredibly strong of yous, and we are just so thankful that yous were able to join and take time out of your evening again. So thank you so much.
Can I just jump in quickly and say that I'm so sorry, I said it wrong. I should have said Our Story Scotland. Sorry, JV and the wonderful team at Our Story Scotland. Of course, it's Our Story Scotland. Apologies. And also just express my personal thanks as well to everyone for joining us, and especially to Remy and to Kasia as well. Thank you.
Yeah. notice that I didn't get that. It was Tommy. I'm so only kidding, Tommy, I'm sure. Yeah, and thank you again to anyone who is watching over Facebook Live as well. We'll be back next week, same time, 7 till 8. We did run over a wee bit, but it's just confused. They're all so fabulous. I just wanted to talk to you all night. So yeah, we'll be back again next week with plenty more culture and critique reviewing and deep dives into politics and all that jazz. So thank you very much. Enjoy the rest of your week. And we'll see you next time for the In Out Crowd. And that's me. Bye.